Hey, this is Marty McFly, and you're listening to Back to the Future Wednesdays exclusively on MNC Podcast.
Wait a minute, Doc. Are you telling me you built a time machine?
You are tuned in to the Monday Night Carlo Sports and Entertainment Sportscast. And now, without further ado, I give to you the one and only Carlo.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Back to the Future Wednesdays, right here exclusively on Monday Night Carlo. And not only have I got one guest, I have two. Two special guests at that. They are part of the Out of Time documentary that you can get behind via Kickstarter, and they are joining me right now. They are Steve Concotelli and Joe Walser. Guys, welcome to the show. How are you?
Hi, we're great. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks for having us.
No problem, man. It's a real honor to have you on. So before we talk all things Back to the Future, let's talk a little bit about you. Just give us a little introduction to the world of Joe and Steve.
Joe, be my guest.
Oh, you, after you.
Well, basically, this is Steve, and I made the documentary about the restoration. I followed Joe and the restoration team for over a year as they worked to restore the actual screen-used time machine from the Back to the Future trilogy, also known as the A car, the hero car. And I shadowed Joe and his team for a year, watching the work they did and compiling all this footage into what will be an awesome movie.
That is very cool, man. How about you, Joe?
Well, as you know, I led the restoration team, like Steve said, for over a year, restoring the hero screen-used DeLorean time machine for Universal Studios and Bob Gale. And thoroughly enjoyed that labor of love. Invited Steve to film all of the intimate moments. basically follow us down the rabbit hole on that epic journey.
So Steve, what is it about this documentary that casual fans can expect? If there's casual fans listening to the podcast right now, what is it in a nutshell that brings this documentary to the table?
Sure. This is a Back to the Future story that's never been told before. It's the story behind the scenes of the real car. It's the real behind the scenes story of what happened to this famous, iconic movie car after the cameras stopped rolling. So we follow the car from its birth through the 80s and 90s into the 2000s, and then up through the restoration as Joe and his team restored it. And it's a great way to just learn some new things you never knew about the time machine, because you know, everybody knows the car, but very few people know a lot about it. And this is that story.
So what of your love of the movie Back to the Future? What is it about this film that you cite as kind of being your favorite film of all time?
Huge question. I mean, there's so many things about Back to the Future that make it the epic movie that it is, and definitely one of my favorites, if not the favorite. It's definitely up there with the top two for a lot of reasons. I mean, I think it's a complicated yet simple story. You know, it's not only about people, but
are those my clocks I hear?
Oh, damn, I'm late for school. It's a story about things I think that interest everyone, and you know, it's cross-generational, and it had the coolest movie car of all time.
Definitely. I think also the innocence of the film. I mean, if you look at films now, and heaven forbid they ever remake the film, I think it would involve a lot more kind of harsh language and drug references. And I think the innocence of the timepiece of the film makes it what it is. What do you guys think to that?
I don't think you should even spread the rumors of possibilities. We gotta stop talking like that right in its tracks, Carl.
Hell yeah.
We can't have any of that. But no, you're...
You know, though, I think it's like in your mind's eye, Back to the Future 4 would be epic. I mean, the problem is the reality of what Back to the Future would be. You know, everybody wants it to happen, but nobody wants it to happen.
So, Joe, just tell me a little bit about kind of the complications of bringing the DeLorean back to its former glory. What was the kind of hardest part of this restoration?
Yeah, that's a good question. There were so many difficult parts of the restoration. As much as I knew about DeLorean time machines going in, there was so much more that I learned
right
along the way. There were a lot of surprises, a lot of information that we weren't expecting. And, you know, I mean, it was really great because you would think by that time you have a plan and you just move through the plan and everything.
Yes.
But every day was full of surprises, and I learned so much. What was the question? The hardest thing?
Yeah, what
most
was the hardest
difficult?
Thing? Yeah.
You know, I mean, speaking in broad general terms, I mean, the hardest thing was nailing it.
Right, okay.
Because it's so involved. You know, I mean, I've been quoted many times saying that it's rather easy to build a time machine, but it's next to impossible to do it right. And,
yes.
I mean, that is the truth. It is so hard because there are thousands of details, and the devil's in the details.
I guess also you're kind of just looking for that perfection of the film as well, you know?
Well, yeah, absolutely. I mean, we weren't interested in building our own version.
Yes.
or bringing our own version of the time machine back to the fans. It was, we wanted to bring the time machine back.
Steve, what was your involvement in the filmmaking process, and how far have you come along the line with that?
Well, I just want to piggyback on what Joe said, because Joe's
okay.
being modest. All right. from watching him work, I can tell you that everything on it, the car was hard. Even simple things like putting wires in the car, like you take a bunch of wires and you stick them here and it looks good. No, even that's difficult because the order of the wires matters, the color, the size,
yes.
the exact placement. All of those details matter to Joe and they matter to the team. And so it was, you know, for the, watching them work relentlessly to make this car 100% film accurate and
yes.
recreating all the imperfections that were in the car that gave it personality, it was astounding. So my hat's off to Joe and the team, because believe me, what their level of work, and when you see the documentary, you'll see the love and dedication and frankly insanity these guys put into this car. It's something to behold.
What is the most kind of fun parts that you guys remember about just doing the work on the car as well? Do you have kind of fun moments where you look back and just laugh about it as well?
I think the funnest moment was when we were done.
Right.
We were exhausted, and you know, it was actually the first time that we got a few hours
yes.
where we could just reflect on what we did. And literally, it was like 4 hours from the point that we finished and Universal came to retrieve the car. And so it was a little window, but it was kind of like the hurricane passed, and we were like, wow, that was insane.
How about for you, Steve?
Well, I'll tell you, there were – once the car started coming back together and it really started looking like the time machine, I think everybody on the team is guilty of when nobody else was around, you'd sit in the driver's seat, you'd push the time circuits, and you'd pretend to be Marty McFly. Like, all of us did it. And
you know,
I don't think you could blame us.
I never did that more than like 10 times.
The funniest part is you just made me insanely jealous, because I'd love a go as well.
it was honestly as cool as you would think it was to sit there knowing that that's where Michael J. Fox, that's where Christopher Lloyd sat in the very seat that
yes.
you're sitting in, and you're singing the song in your head, and you feel very cool and very geeky at the same time.
Yeah, I think now I'm going to change my story to that was the coolest thing. The other thing was just the most rewarding and relaxing, you know. But you're right, that was epic.
So, Steve, as far as the movie itself goes, how do you even come close to deciding what gets edited and what gets cut from this film? How do you put that together?
Yeah, that's the big question. over the course
well,
of the restoration...
I can answer that. We're going to edit out all of the things that showed me doing anything that wasn't 100% safe.
That's a lot of footage right there.
Yeah, no cutting metal on my lap while I was sitting, you know, on the floor. None of that.
Never happened.
I won't make the film. I'll always be wearing eye protection.
Yes, we always did. But the truth is, I shot over 40 hours of footage, I think, and
really?
We're cutting it down to about a one-hour documentary. And what it's a matter of is it's going through and finding fascinating moments that casual fans can enjoy, yet very hardcore Back to the Future fans can still get can learn some knowledge from. You know, it's making sure that it appeals to the entire spectrum. It's not guys wrenching on a car. It's not a car restoration. It's the story of this legendary prop and these loving, caring fans doing whatever it takes to bring it back to life.
Tell us about the team. What are the rest of the team like, and what was their involvement?
That's for me, I guess. you know, our team was comprised of a lot of both, you know, intense Back to the Future fans, but also some highly skilled professionals. I mean, and that was kind of the beauty of our team. It's, you know, it's one thing to just be a big group of fanatics, but to do this job right, you know, it actually took a lot of skill. It wasn't, you know, just a smash and grab. It was everything from research and archaeology and, you know, CSI investigations to, you know, electronics, components that needed to be, designed, engineered, built, tested, you know, along with a lot of other, you know, technical things that people, you know, wouldn't necessarily think of. I mean, you know, anybody with a can of spray paint, you know, can technically paint. But we, you know, we brought in movie industry professional painters and people, you know, who paint using special effects techniques. I mean, we really, we wanted it to be perfect. We wanted it to look just like it did when it rolled off Doc Brown's truck and have all the danger and the mystique and the leaky oil, you know, streaks that make you feel like at any moment it could explode and you all be killed.
So looking at it from the outside, Steve, how is that for you? And are you a car guy too?
You know what? I am not a car guy in the least. I can't change my oil. I don't have any of the technical skills that the team had because, you know, Joe comes from an art direction background.
Right.
And there were guys on the team who had, I mean, there were engineers, there were genuine like rocket engineers working on the team. And so the skill level of the team was just insane. My skill that I brought involved standing off to the side and not wrecking anything while I shot with a video camera. That was the skill I brought. And you
for
know,
the most
luckily,
part, you did that very well.
Yeah, exactly.
For the well, my favorite for the most was like part. Steve's trying, you know, to get the shot, and you know, the DeLorean's tight, and so you can actually kind of appreciate, you know, some of the things that the original filmmakers went through, you know, having to shoot inside such a tiny area. But you know, I remember many times where, you know, you'd be working on something, and then all of a sudden get hit right in the forehead and you look over and there's Steve with his camera and it's like, dude, I hope you got that shot.
Yeah, it's up close and personal. I bring the audience right there.
I guess with a few Back to the Future quotes thrown in along the way, there's got to be though, yeah?
constant is the right word, I think. Like, you would think that, like, again, all these guys working on this car for so long that you'd get tired of Back to the Future quotes, but you never do.
Oh, never, never ever.
No, and in fact, it was kind of a challenge, you know what I mean? It was one Back to the Future quote after another, and you know, who could come up with the one quote, you know, that hadn't yet been exhausted.
Kind of keeping the sanity going, Joe, yeah?
Yeah, you got to keep the interest up.
Hell yeah.
You're tuned into Monday Night Carlo, the sports pop culture podcast, available on iTunes, Spreaker, and Stitcher Radio. So why not hit that subscribe button now? Monday Night Carlo, where pop culture fun lives.
So Kickstarter, how can the people listening get involved with your Kickstarter, and what kind of are the rewards that are on the table for that?
Well, we wanted to do something different for our Kickstarter. We wanted to offer things that you can't get through any other Kickstarter, you know, or Back to the Future items you can't find anywhere else.
Yes.
So I worked very closely with Joe, and we came up with a bunch of things that you can only get here. For example, there's a beautiful photo we took of the car the night it was finished, and it's
nice.
The same photo that they used for the Lego booklet.
Oh, and very cool.
For the first time, you know, we're offering that as an exclusive poster through our Kickstarter. We have full-size movie posters, but best of all, and I think Joe will agree with me on this, is for the first time ever, we're offering 5x7 desktop displays containing pieces from the time machine.
That is very, very cool.
Absolutely. Yep,
and that's thanks to Joe.
Well, it was such a clever idea. You know, while we were doing the restoration, you know, there was always talk about, you know, what to do with
yes.
some of the things that, you know, needed to be replaced. You know, we hung on to some of those things. And the intent was always, you know, to figure out a way, you know, to make those things accessible to, you know, the fans, the people who adore the car, our supporters. And when Steve had that idea, I was like, it's a no-brainer. It was meant to be.
So is it hard to decide on things that you actually want to keep for yourselves? Are there moments where you just think, oh, I've got to keep hold of this, you know?
Actually, no. The thing is, you know, I mean, I can see how it would be tempting, but the rule of thumb was, you know, if it could be fixed, if it could be repaired or restored, then it was.
Yes.
And it's as simple as that. You know, and whatever was left over was stuff that had to be replaced.
So starting with Steve, let's talk Back to the Future memorabilia itself. Do you guys own any at all?
Oh, gosh. I'm the wrong person to ask. I own one single piece of memorabilia. I purchased a Krupp's coffee grinder, just like Mr. Fusion. I bought one and with the hopes of turning it into a Mr. Fusion, but that's it. And I say that with a certain amount of shame because compared to Joe, compared to Terry, compared to everybody else on the restoration team, these guys have fantastic memorabilia that puts me to shame. Like, most of them are DeLorean owners. Most of them have built and own time machine replicas, and I haven't even come close to that yet.
So as far as the DeLorean go, do most of the guys own kind of the DeLorean from the first movie, or is it, you know, do you guys go for the trilogy?
Well, actually, I think pretty much everybody on the team started out wanting the nuclear version from the first film. And then, you know, as you go, everybody sort of graduates to wanting basically everything, you know, because they're like, well, now I have a time machine with a nuclear reactor, and it's not, you know, it's not that much more work to convert it to the Mr. Fusion version. So pretty much everybody has the option of both.
Do you yourself own a DeLorean too?
I do not. I did build one. That's how this all started for me. And, you know, that was the thing that, you know, sent me headfirst down this rabbit hole. And, you know, my goal was to, there were other time machine replicas out there, but none of them were really what I considered, you know, up to par in the accuracy department. So that's where I went with it. I decided that I was going to try to build a completely accurate time machine. For the most part, I succeeded, but I don't own the car anymore. I sold it at a Profiles in History charity auction for Team Fox back during the first We're Going Back events in 2010.
Very cool, man.
And that car is how Joe and I met, actually. Because
really?
Joe found me online, and he sent me a picture of his car.
You were
and
online
I,
dating, and then, oh, wait, no.
Yeah, exactly.
That's not how it happened.
But he sent me a picture, and I said, whose car is that? And he said, mine. I'm building it. And I think I literally drove over to his condo the next night just to see it.
Yeah.
And it was still in progress. It wasn't done, and it was the coolest thing I'd ever seen. And from that moment, I'm like, Joe, you are somebody I want to hang around with.
That is very cool. So speaking of Joe, Steve, I know he's here on the line with us, but just seeing it from the outside, just again, just tell us a little bit more about Joe himself, seeing it from your angle, you know?
Sure. I don't mind bragging about Joe because, to be honest, it was his vision
yes.
that really guided the team. You know, he had one rule, and that was perfection or nothing.
Yes.
Where everything had to be perfect. Stuff you would never see, stuff inside of things had to be perfect. And that really guided the team. It gave the team focus, and the team aspired to achieve that. And, you know, and it was really a fantastic sight to see because these guys pushed themselves past every conceivable limit that you could working on a movie prop to make it right. And Joe really set the bar for that. And I think, you know, a lot of us who go and see the car as fans can be grateful that he and the team hit that level.
Joe, do you see yourself as kind of a perfectionist, or is it just something that drives you to make things perfect?
I know actually a lot of people sort of see me as a perfectionist, maybe even slightly obsessed, maybe not even slightly.
Right.
But, you know, it's just for me, you know, my line in the sand is just a lot further than it is for most people. I just figure if it's worth doing at all, it's worth doing right. You know, otherwise you can just, you know, have somebody else do it.
Definitely.
You know, but it is kind of important for me, you know, to do a good job. And the Time Machine's been, and Back to the Future, you know, it's been kind of guiding light, kind of, you know, ever since I was a teenager and saw it, it's just sort of always existed for me. And
yes.
I couldn't not do right by that whole, I don't know, energy experience franchise.
Right, yeah.
I just had to do right by the Time Machine. And, you know, and the opportunity for me to participate in this, you know, especially to the level, you know, that I was able to be involved was so huge and so monumental. I don't see how anybody, given that exact situation, could ever choose anything less than everything.
And what's great is when the movie comes out, Carl, you'll get to see for yourself and you'll get to decide for yourself. Is Joe a perfectionist or is he something more? So,
you know, I got to take this time out to give a very important shout out to my partner on the restoration, Terry Metalis,
okay,
who was the producer. And I literally couldn't have done it without him.
Right.
You know, he was responsible for, you know, all of the
go-between
dealings between. Yeah, he was like the liaison between Universal. He dealt with Universal. He dealt with all of the, you know, the things that needed to happen in order for me to meet the goals that that were set. You know, and he did a lot of the prop archaeology and, you know, did a lot of legwork tracking down companies that we needed to hire to handle various aspects of the restoration and then also, you know, to hire them.
So, Steve, as far as you go, do you have anyone to thank?
Joe will completely agree with me is that without Bob, none of this would have happened. Bob was a champion of the restoration from the very beginning. He's one of the people who helped get it off the ground.
Yes.
And, you know, he was instrumental in the restoration, and he was instrumental in this documentary. I mean, for Bob to help us and tell this story is incredible, and to have his support and his enthusiasm and his knowledge and experience was just – as a fan, it was unbelievable. It's like being inside the Back to the Future franchise, and you can't help but smile every time you think about it. And,
yeah, Bob was absolutely, you know, our champion. Without him and his guidance and involvement, you know, this would all remain the pipe dream, you know, that it was.
And
for many of us, you know, the ultimate goal was always, you know, the hope anyway to restore the DeLorean Time Machine. You know, it's all fans, you know, I'd spent any time with it, wanted to save it, wanted to restore it, you know, but until Bob stepped in, that's exactly what it was, a pipe dream.
So tell us about Bob as a person. How do you guys find him, and how is he as a person all round?
I mean, I have an endless number of great things to say about Bob, but Steve?
Yeah, I mean, Bob, he's nicer in person than you could even imagine. I mean,
really?
He's the guardian of the franchise. He gets fans. He appreciates fans. He takes time to talk to fans, and he understands why we love Back to the Future. I mean, he gets it. He does. And, you know, for him to help us and to encourage us and, you know, for me as a fan to allow me inside the franchise a little bit and to tell this story is, you know, it's a fantastic experience.
Oh yeah. I mean, I couldn't agree more. Bob has always been super accessible and incredibly supportive And, you know, no matter what crazy idea we came up with, you know, he was always right there saying, yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is all so great. You know, I mean, ultimately, you know, we all kind of share the same love for Back to the Future.
Yes.
You know, and everything that is, you know, good and positive, you know, is a good and positive thing. And so it's been such a great experience because Bob's been so involved and supportive. You know, it really, I think, raised the bar for us, you know, on kind of an emotional level too, because it was like, you know, we really wanted to make Bob proud, and it was important for us too. And we did.
That is very, very cool. So Steve, just for one more time, just for those people that are kind of on the verge of clicking that button and clicking more dollars to your Kickstarter campaign, just tell us one more time all about Out of Time and what the Back to the Future community of fans can expect from your film. What sets it apart, Steve?
Out of Time is the greatest comeback story in movie prop history. It is the untold story of the real screen-use time machine.
Yes.
And what happened to it after cameras stopped rolling. It's a story about the most famous film car in the world. It's a story about fans. It's a story about passion. And it's a story that every fan of Back to the Future can enjoy and learn something new from. And that's what you get from our film.
That is very, very cool. Guys, I'm excited. I don't know about you, but I'm excited anyway, you know?
We're always excited. It's, but yeah.
Yeah.
That is very cool.
It's been a huge labor of love, yeah. It's a labor of love for the restoration, has been a labor of love for Joe, and the film is a labor of love of mine. And together we want to let fans be there at the restoration and so they can see what Joe and the team did. It's really amazing.
Steve, Joe, it's been an amazing chat. So thank you so much for coming on the podcast.
Pleasure's all mine.
And mine.
Fired off. Okay, I want channels 18, 24, 63, 109, 87, and the weather channel.
You have been listening to Monday Night Carlo. All news and opinions expressed by Carlo are all his own and do not represent any other entity.